Okay, good afternoon. First of all, thank you for the Integration Monday team for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Sandro Pereira. I'm a Microsoft Integration MVP from Portugal. I'm working in DevScope, a Portuguese company that works with Microsoft technologies, integration, CRM, Checkpoint, and so on. And since 2011, I'm a Microsoft Integration MVP. I write in several blogs. I have my own personal blog, Sandro BizTalk blog. I'm a member and co-founder of BizTalk crew that is responsible for creating a lot of BizTalk events in Europe. I'm a TechNet Wiki article member and a moderator also, and a contributor of MSA and TechNet galleries and so on. So you will probably find me in many contributions. Last year I released a book about BizTalk mapping that was published by BizTalk 360. It's free, so I hope you can enjoy, download, and enjoy. And I think it will be useful. And today's session is about BizTalk Server tips and tricks for admin and also for developers. And additionally, I have some extra tips for you. So I've been presenting this session since the London event. This is not the same session. I have more tips, but because this kind of Integration Monday is more open, I can take longer time, and instead I will speak about every tips, but I'm hoping that I be able to show you every single tip working. So, because we have more time. Start about some BizTalk tips and tricks for admins, for this type of guys that you well know, Torgl Ramadal. So, and the first tip will be about a tip that I'm calling trying to annoy Torgl using PowerShell. So, if you have been following BizTalk Innovation Days or BizTalk Summit, you probably already have heard Torgl complaining about developers writing in the event viewer a lot of events like message arrive, message transform, message send, and so on. And he also complained that developers shouldn't do that. I agree with him. You shouldn't write in the event viewer, especially in the application log, okay? Because the application log is very important for monitoring BizTalk environments. It's in the application log that BizTalk and SQL and other products write the errors informations about what are happening in the environment. So if any BizTalk problems happens, BizTalk will write in the application log. So you may want to have this application log clean of noise to be able to proper monitor. But you know, developers, I am a developer and I am also an admin. So developers always forget this kind of stuff, and they will write a lot of noise in the event log. Normally what admins does is try to speak with the team to change their code and so on and blah, blah, blah. So, okay. You can do that, but sometimes it's a fight that you cannot win. They will try to convince you that this information is very important for them and so on and so on. So what should they do is to take control of their environment. You don't need for the developer to change that code. You can easily, using PowerShell script, change this behavior and change that the log that is writing the application be write to a different application, a custom application, okay? By, again, simply write a simple PowerShell script that will do that for you. I will show you this tip working. I will try not to every time switch slides, but this I will show you. So we have a receive orchestration that a dummy orchestration that will force writing different logs in the application. So by default, if a source is not registered, if this key is not registered to any application, it will add automatically in the application log. Okay. So I have this one. This is a simple orchestration that receives log message and put in the file. So if you try this, and put copy again. And I think it's already processing. It's fast. And if you refresh this, you will see that a lot of information saying message transform, message send, message received, and so on. So this is creating a lot of noise in the event viewer. You can easily omit important source, and it will be difficult to find any BizTalk problem that you can happen. So I create a simple PowerShell script. Let me show you. So basically, what I'm doing is if the annoying Tor exists, in this case is annoying Tor 2. I will create a custom log called stupid developers, just to have fun, and I will move the key from the application log and move to a different custom log. Okay, if I run that. Yes, okay. After doing that, I need to restart the event log service, otherwise it will, the changes will not make it doesn't enter, so you need to restart for the changes to take effect. It will take just a minute to restart the service. And this is a basic PowerShell script that check if the log exists, otherwise you create the custom source and move it to a different one. So now if I do the same, I think it's already processed. Yes, it's processing. So let me refresh that. So there isn't now the annoying Tor disappear from the application, and if you check in the stupid developers custom log, it's starting it's starting to appear the annoying Tor 2. And without changing my code, it's able to fix this behavior in the in my environment. Okay. What RosettaNet, ESP, UDI, all of these have in common? And the response is that all of these features, these optional features in BizTalk, have a custom database. So UDI have it has the UDI 3 database, ESP has 2 or 3 database, RosettaNet have 3 different database that are to support these features in BizTalk. And the question that you should ask is, do you think these databases are being backed up by default using the default jobs of BizTalk? Does your platform back up all of these so you can restore and be safe? And the question is no. By default, BizTalk doesn't back up this extra database. Fortunately for us, BizTalk provides 2 SQL scripts, a backup setup all procs and backup setup all tables that you can use to implement these backupping mechanisms of BizTalk for this extra database. You also need to modify the IDE model backup database in the BizTalk management database. And in this way, BizTalk jobs, the backup job of BizTalk, will backup and maintain this database, okay? I will show in a moment this deep working, but again, in database, all BizTalk database has a table called MacLog, in the exception, of course, of the BAMSTAR schemas and the custom database that are being created by the ESB, UDI, or RosettaNet features. The rest, all the database has this table. And this table only contains a string that is being stored in each 50 minutes. That is the mark of the timestamp, is a timestamp in the string format when the log backups of the logs are being made, okay? But none of the existing jobs clean these tables, which means that each 50 minutes a string is created in the every single database that has the mark log table. And this will, after a while, will grow and your database will start to become bigger also because of this. And the solution provided by Microsoft is using the Terminator tool, or now the BizTalk Health Monitor, because BizTalk Health Monitor V3 as the Terminator inside. So this means that you need to stop your environment to purge all the information exists on that table. Okay. Again, I don't agree with this approach, and you don't need to stop your environment to maintain these tables. So I end up creating a custom store procedure that is a replica of the delete backup history store procedure that exists in BizTalk, and I extend its functionalities to be able to go to these tables and clean the logs based on the days to keep that you pass in the delete backup history job, okay? I also need to thank Storglad Nadal, my co-workers Rui Romani, Pedro Souza, and Michael Sand for helping me creating this store procedure. Let me show these 2 tips working. Let me show you the backups. Backup. So Let me force a full backup. So if you see, I have all the BizTalk database being basically, I have this bitarn archive. This is one of the database of RosettaNet. But RosettaNet has two more databases. Okay. So let me. Okay. Let me choose a different table, configure, and apply these two SQL scripts. So I'm running against this archive database. Oh, sorry, it was the config database. Config database, and with the data database. And the same to these ones, the config and the data. So these two job SQL scripts, I run against this extra database. Now I also need to go to the other backup database and add these configurations. I'm adding the custom database that I want to backup. So again, if I force a new backup being generated, I now hopefully see that I have rconfig and bitarn now being backup. Using the BizTalk job, backup job, okay. And let me just close this. Again, like I told before, each has a matlock table that I want to find a way. There it is. They only contain this type of string that is a timestamp being marked. Okay. So again, these tables never, by default, they never are being clean. They are still always growing. So I end up creating this custom store procedure that I allowed to read inside of these tables, and based on the days to keep of the backup that I can see there. That in my case is 14. Well, all the strings that are held then 14 days are being by default and each 15 minutes clean in this table. Okay, I just need to change the last step of the backup job. Instead to use backup default backup history, that is the default store procedure, to use this one. Okay. SAP adapter and SAP adapter, sorry, and the support of 34 bits. I see a lot of confusion on the web about the SAP adapter. Someone says that they are not supporting in 34 bits, only 32 bits is working. You need to copy and paste different SDKs of the SAP RFC DLLs to different folders and so on. And the truth is that SAP adapter supports 34 bits always. Okay, you need to have the 32 and the 34 bits because the 32 is mandatory. You all know that Visual Studio and BizTalk admin console are running 32 bits, so you always need to add the 32 bits, but you can add the 34 bits and use the 34 bits, okay? Also, there are a lot of confusion about Unicode version, non-Unicode version of the SAP system and so on. No matter what your SAP system is Unicode or non-Unicode, you always need to download the Unicode RFC SDK from the SAP marketplace, okay? Another confusion is where are the resources, and probably is why there are a lot of confusion about the SAP adapter is you don't have access to the SAP marketplace. You need to have a special account. You need to be a partner of the SAP and so on to be able to download these SDKs. And because you depend, sometimes you depend on other teams to download Unicode, you need to say what really you need to have. So one of my problems was I was asking the SDK and they only give me one SDK. So I had, in the first time, I had a lot of problems installing the SDK, installing the SAP adapter. So under the marketplace, you will find two SDKs always. One is the Windows Server EA 32, that is 32 bits, and one is the 34. You always need to ask these two from your SAP team. You also need the R3 DLL inst zip. That has some DLLs there that you need to install, and the subcard that is a kind of zip to extract the SAP files. Okay. You also need to download the Microsoft Visual Studio C++, but this is Microsoft, so you'll be able to get this resource. And the last is the installation. And yes, you need to copy and paste different DLLs with the same name to different folders, and the 34 bits SDK you need to copy for the system 32, and the 32 you need to copy to the sys 1 34. You also need to install the DLLs present in the R3 DLL inst XZ tool in the system 32. You will find sometimes you have the installation in this this file is the installation, but sometimes you if you execute it will install in the system 1 34. You need to check that. If that happens, you need to copy these exact same files to the system 32 files. Okay, and after that you have the SAP adapter working well on 34 bits or 32 bits. Unfortunately, I cannot show you this because I already have installed in my machine. Another tip about using PowerShell, because I think PowerShell is one of the most amazing tools for admins, and is about tracking data. Again, I am a developer and I am an administrator, and sometimes I develop and install my solutions in production. Even me, I forget to clean the tracking data before I create the MSI to install in my environment. So, by default, full tracking is enabled in developer environment, and developers will always forget to clean that. It's impossible. Even me, I forget every single time that I need to create to clean the tracking from the MSCI. And normally, admins again try to discuss with the team for creating for create the MSCI and clean all this tracking feature from before they create the MSCI files to that need to be deployed to production. But again, actually developers, they don't care about that. It's not their task to do that, and they will completely forget every single time. So again, it's better, in my opinion, of course, to have, I mean, take control of the environment and forget about the developers, okay? You can create a simple PowerShell script to automate this task, because this task is annoying. You need to go to the orchestrations, clean the tracking, go to the pipelines, clean the tracking. So you need to go to every single artifact to check if the trackings are enabled or not. So it's very simple to create a PowerShell script that you can use to clean every single tracking feature, or just to have a particular tracking for example, orchestration start and so on. So you can customize your tracking preference according to your idea, what you need to track in your client and so on. And we use this PowerShell script every time you should you will deploy a new solution, or just to check if everything is configured well. I will show that. I want to speak about another PowerShell script. I think every client has a message archiving folder. Okay, it's very common that a client has folders just to put the message that are receiving from ACP or SQL or the standard system, just to have a backup for a retry mechanism. Probably is more common in the first stage of the integration scenarios, that you need to don't have entirely sure if everything will work or not, so they want to keep a copy of the message so they can reprocess quickly and in a simple way, just by using filters and reports and so on. The problem is after doing that, you will forget that you have a archive folder. And what will happen is that the folder will start to contain many files, and you have two problems there. Many files in the folder can cause performance problems. This means that even the copy from the adapter, using the file adapter to copy to put the file on the folder, will start to be slower. You will start to use consuming threads, so other processes will probably also get delayed, and will cause probably cause some of performance in your BizTalk environments. The most critical is you can reach a point of disk being full if you don't have your monitoring mechanism implemented well in your environment. And for me, it's better to have active approach. And since the first day, you can create a PowerShell script that can easily monitor and clean these archiving folders for you. So you just need to create one time, reuse it every time you want, different folders and so on. I will show you also this working. Again, with using PowerShell. I love BizTalk 360. For me, it's one of the best tools for monitoring BizTalk. It does amazing things. You also have other different tools like AIMS and so on. But sometimes we don't have this tool. We have small clients that cannot afford or doesn't want to afford to buy an external tool, or they are thinking, but in the first stage they don't have this tool. So you need to have some monitoring in your environment. I know you can use COM and so on, other stuff if they have better, but sometimes they don't have these tools. And PowerShell is a technology that you can use to create some basic rudimentary tools for monitoring your environment. You can easily monitoring suspensions instance in BizTalk using PowerShell, Windows update using PowerShell. You can monitor the space disk using PowerShell. If the SQL jobs are running or not, these are some basic examples that you can use and implement easily in your environment to have a minimum of monitor in your environment. Okay, let me show that for you. So I have my environment. If I go to the all artifacts orchestrations, if I select all, you can see that I will have all tracking options enabled in my BizTalk environment. What I did was just creating a PowerShell script that disabled all tracking settings. Again, if you don't are comfortable in disabling all the tracking settings, you can adjust the script just to enable some of the tracking and disable the rest of the setting. Okay, this is using the LME and those for education in my environment, and disable all orchestration tracking or sandbox. Execute this, start to see that this is I have in my environment. Okay, already finished, and if I refresh that, you will see that if I check the tracking, everything is disabled. Okay, so I just spend one afternoon on the developing this portion I need to do. It's single time I want. Okay, so the other PowerShell script was the zipping the archive files. So I have one scenario when my client has archive folder. Each inside the archive folder, they have many different folders received, sent from different application, and they want to go there, check if there are messaging more than 12 that has that older than 12 hours, and just zip the files and put in a share environment. Okay, so I end up creating this post that goes to one folder and check all the create a zip file and just copy to a different location. Okay, that is called backup file warehouse. I don't know if I have some problems here. Probably I have some. It doesn't exist. Okay, I already delete this for so. I don't have the folders enabled here, created here. But as you can see, easily I can create this and I'm no longer have to worry about my disk being full or containing too much message, because I have an automatic process that is cleaning up my environment. So creating some monitoring basic features using PowerShell. Again, it's very simple. These scripts are available in TechNet gallery, so you can download it and try it. Each PowerShell just check if something is happening and if is some suspended message or if the job are not running, they will send me an email for me to take some actions. So I have my email settings here. In this case, I will go to check if there is any suspenses messages. In BizTalk, HTML, and I will send an email if some suspended message is there. You can also monitor, for example, the event viewer from some BizTalk errors. So in this case, I'm checking the last 4 hours if there is some error that is related with the BizTalk server source. And if so, again, I'm just creating an email and send it by email. So if I make, I don't know if I can put a start point here, but let me check. I reached the breakpoint. Let me check if I have color. Yeah, 2. So if I'm going my HLM message, because my email doesn't. No. Mail body. Okay. She's email validator error, debatching person, other errors that I have in the event viewer. So I will receive an email with this context if I implement this type of monitoring. And the last one, for example, is checking if the SQL job is running. So I could go to the history checking if there are errors there, but I realized that in a scenario that I have in a client, everything was running, everything was being green, so I didn't have any error in the job history. But what I realize is that the jobs, they haven't been running since the last 4 days. And the problem is the SQL agent was starting, but it was in a state that is not, it didn't work. So it was like a zombie. And after a restart of the SQL agent, it starts to work again. So I end up creating, for example, this this SQL script that is going to my history, and it will check if everything is running, is enabled, and it also will check if the last occurrence has been made in the time frame that I'm being placed here. So each 15 minutes, each 1 day or two, something like that, and so on. And with PowerShell script, again, I can execute the SQL query. And if some problems are person, I will create a job. This is a way to create some rudimentary monitoring, but I will find very useful if you don't have the right tools like Software 60 or other tools. So let's go helper that for this kind of person that you probably know, Nino Cordelli, my friend that also probably is here seeing this webinar. So and the first tip is the batching message, okay? I find this interesting because each time I ask some developer how they make the batching inside BizTalk, they say they create an envelope, they create a schema, and they create a custom pipeline to make the debatching of this message, so specifying the envelope and specifying the schema. That normally is a replica of the XML RPC pipeline. The question is, do I really need to do each single time that I want to make a debatch, do a custom pipeline or not? You can, but you don't need to create a custom pipeline to do that. Okay, you don't need to create each time you want to make a debatch a custom pipeline. You probably can, you need to create a custom pipeline if you want to debatch and validate, because by default you don't have a pipeline that does that for you. But you can create a generic pipeline and in runtime or inside the BizTalk administration console specify the schemas or not that you want to validate. Because for example, to debatch you don't need to specify the envelope and the schema. You just need to create the envelope and schema, and the envelope just mark as an envelope and specify the body path. And that's it. The XML receipt pipeline will do the job for you. They will split, it will split the message. Okay, you don't need to specify nothing more. I will show that in a moment. But before that, let's talk about the next tip. That is similar to the first one. So what about flat files? Because flat files is the same. You usually create a pipeline with a flat file disassembled for each flat file that you want to transform for a flat file to XML. So I have in the past a project that has like 100 flat files, different flat files. And when I start, when I take the project, I have 100 flat files and 100 pipelines. So you can imagine the huge amount of artifacts that I have in that kind of solution. I end up creating only 100 flat files and one pipeline. Because the reality is, again, you don't need to create a custom pipeline just to validate or just to make the disassemble of a text file to an XML file. You can easily create a custom pipeline to do that. And again, in runtime, in the administration console, config this generic pipeline to disassemble the different files that you want. Okay, let me show that for you. So let's close this. I don't no longer need it, and let's close this. So let's back to Visual Studio and let's see the project debatching pipelines. Okay, normally we have the envelope that will mark as an envelope, and we define the body XPath expect to the correct value. And we have the schema itself, that is what is inside the envelope. And by default, normally we create this kind of pipeline specifying the document schemas, specifying the document schemas and the envelope schemas, okay? That is what normally we do. And if you're using the validate, again, we specify the schemas that you want to validate. You can also, so if this is normal, but we can create a generic validated pipeline. So here I have the same, but I don't specify nothing in my pipeline. So everything is clean. Let's see this in action. And to see the difference between one of and the others. So I have here three receive locations. One is using the custom pipeline that I create. You can see that I have specified the person, the envelope, and the person in the component. This came by default from Visual Studio when I deployed the pipeline. One is using the standard XML receive with nothing there. And the other is receiving the, is using the custom XML validator that I create, but I have a different configuration here. Okay, I want to validate the person if everything is correct or not, and if the message is in the incorrect, it will be suspended, and the correct ones will be processed. So I have the recovery and exchange process get through. But I have a different configuration here. Let me open the notepad to read better. Format font. Okay. So I have this kind of stuff. I have the namespace, the schema name, and then separator. I don't know the name in English, and the full qualifier of the assembly. Okay, I can use this syntax to also be able to config this property inside the BizTalk admin console. So, if I run that, let's try debatching. So, I don't have nothing here. I have this envelope with one or two messages with error. So, if I execute the custom pipeline that I created in Visual Studio specifying the schemas and the envelopes, we'll see that it's being processed. And three of them are being executed, and if we check here, one is being suspended. Yeah, okay. So let's clean that, just not to create noise. And let's clean the output. So now, we will use the generic receive pipeline, again, with errors. And the output will be, we will have the debatching done for us by default. You will see that we have four different messages, so it will debatch, but it will not validate the message. Because I don't have nothing specified here that I want to validate. Sorry, it's not this one, it's this. that I want to validate, I don't have the validator there, okay? If I put the validator here, we will only validate the envelope. So, the last option is using the validator pipeline, the generic validator pipeline that I create. And again, if you execute that, we will have the same tree being processed and one being suspended. Okay? So, I can reuse this pipeline for each disassemble and validation process that I want. The same goes for the flat file. So let me close these because we don't need more. And let's go to a different solution. We have here the transformation file. So again, I have two different flat files that I have here, persons and address, okay. And normally, what we do is to create, for example, a custom pipeline just to process this file to convert it from a text to XML, or we'll create a pipeline to make the disassemble and to validate the message. Again, we always need to specify the document schema here. So for each pipeline, for each process, flat file process, we always create different pipelines. What you could do is create a generic flat file receiver. And okay, you cannot use a flat file without specifying any document schema. You have to specify, otherwise it will give a compile error. So I end up creating this flat file and put a generic base type any that is available from the Microsoft Xlang DLL by default in BizTalk. Because I specify a generic schema here, it allows me to deploy to my environment. So I have this flat file generic receive pipeline. And if I use, again, in my transformation, flat file transformations example, I have a custom pipeline, that is what we normally have, that you can see. I will have the generic pipeline, here the flat file receive, that's my generic pipeline. And again, using the same syntax that I showed before, namespace, name of the transformation, the schema, and the assembly name, you can specify the document that I want to transform from flat file to XML. You can see that I also using the same flat file for a different different schema. So the first one I'm using the persons and the second the address. So if you try that again, just to see that I'm not joking, let me transform. I have persons here. Let me check if I have. Okay, let me clean. Let me put the persons here. Okay, I'm doing the transformation and the debatching at the same time. So I have the persons, and for each of them I have my XML file. Okay, let me clean. So if I use the same in the generic pipeline that I have, I will have the same output there. Okay. And to see that is working, I have a different file that is address. If I put there, I will also have a different output and this type is address. So again, in my environment under BizTalk, I'm change the console. I can change these properties without creating different artifacts. And I can reduce the number of artifacts, and for that, I think it's better for performance also. So, then, request response using log operations and content-based routing. Okay, I joined these two concepts, content-based routing and log operations. Content-based routing is simple, but sometimes using log operations and request response, it can be a little difficult to understand because, okay, you have a receive port that is requesting a response, and you have a send port, and you can create a filter to the receive port, but you cannot create a filter in the receive port for the send because you don't need it. If you in the request response, you only need the filter from the send, create a, in the send port, a filter to the receive location or receive port, and will automatically address the response to that port also. But using log operations, you also have a problem. You need to, for example, if you're using SQL or if you are using SAP, you need to specify the action and the operation. You will see that in the bindings in the send ports. So if you are making an insert in the database, you need to specify insert action and the operation as an insert or other name and so on. And this action and this operation needs to be promoted. And because you are using content-based routing, you need to find a way to promote this operation. Okay, that's the main problem, is to promote the operation. You can use different stuff like business rules or other stuff, but for me the easy and the most effective way is to create a custom pipeline and a pipeline component that will only promote this operation, and you can reuse it whenever you want also. I will show again this in a few minutes for you to understand better. But talking about content-based routing, let's talk about using business rules to help implement content-based routing. So if you are familiar with business rules and content-based routing and you have this type of scenarios, you also find very interest the business rules pipeline framework that is is available on Codeplex and is very useful. It will add business rules with a lot of new features. But one of the problems is extending this framework. For example, I have a scenario when I need to exchange files, only exchange files, but the rules of this exchange was in the name of the file. So the first part of the file was the partner, the second was the process, and so on and so on. So in this case, kind of scenario, I need to go to the name of the file, extract the different parts, route them to different places, and change the name of the file to a different name. I could extend the framework, the business rule engine pipeline framework, to do that. But these were rules that are particular for this integration. I will not use for any other integration, so I don't find it useful to extend the framework itself, because it's more difficult to manage the versions and so on. But be able to call, for example, static functions from an Apple class that will allow me to extend the business rules capabilities. By default, business rules doesn't allow you to invoke static members of a .NET class. But fortunately for us, we can modify this behavior. And with a simple registry, key in the register, we can be able to support static methods and invoke them by in business rules. So I will show these two tips working. And the first one is I have this close this. Okay. I have this table where I have persons that I want to insert, delete, and consult, make some selects. So I end up creating, let me check if I have the solutions. Yeah. So yeah, I have my schemas of the SQL for the insert, select, and delete, and I have maps for my input to my SQL input and response for my response. I have this available in the WCF or service, web service, and that after that is calling the SQL. And again, let me show you the contact database routing. So I have a receive location that is a web service, the OCF, and the send port is SQL that has a filter. Okay, that has a filter for my receive location, and the maps itself are in the receive port, sorry. So I have my all maps, inbound maps to transform my WCF to my SQL schema, and I have output maps from the SQL response to my WCF response. The trick here is again to promote the operation. Okay. Sorry about that. So I create this content-based run promote operation that has the XML assembly and only the content-based route operation promotion. That what I did was create a decode component. Let me show you the execute. Okay. I did was go into the message type of the schema, and you know, if you are using the IDOC of the SQL schema, you only have these logs, this namespace, and the last option is the name of the operation, like the insert. Let me try to show you. Not there. So doesn't mind. You have the operations inside. Okay. The person, the insert, and so on. There. insert there. So I end up creating this to go to the message type, going checking the remove the namespace, and in the last is the name of the root element that I want to promote as an operation. And what I did is configure this name as insert, delete, and select, and match them to the action that I want in insert, delete, and select. Okay, after that, I can, for example, make the select, and will return me all the records that has Sandro there. I can add names, system cars 199999, and check. Okay, operation complete. If you go here, make select again. So everything is running. So basically, I only need to promote the operation to be able to make context-based routing with load operations. The second, the other tip was this scenario. I call the file postman. So I have this name, Sandro, that is like the partner. This is the different type of message that I want to send to my partner, and the rest is the name of the company, and this last piece is the name that I want to give the file in the destination. Okay, so this is the incoming file, and based on these restrictions, these rules, I want to put this file name under different folders. So I end up going to the register and the business rules 3.0 and create a static support equal to 2. By doing that, I am able now to call static methods in my business rules. So in my code, I create this support class that is getting the file indicator, just split the files based on the rules that I want, and set the file name that I want in the destination. In my business rules that I create, so I'm using the support get file indicator from the file receive file name, and I'm checking if it's equal to Sandro AADI. If so, I'm using the helper class to set file name, to set a different file name in the destination. I'm just basically removing this nomenclature for the file. And I'm doing that for the different types of message that I want: SMIC, Mango, TSMC, ADI, and so on. I could create some dynamic port, but instead I choose to have different send ports. Where are you? I choose to have different send ports because then I can stop and stop whenever I want if I know if the client has a problem, because this was not to be a flat file but like an FTP or something like that. And in each one, and I have a filter for the operation that I'm also promoting in my business rules. So here I'm also promoting my destination property that I have created in my dynamic file postname property schema. So if I'm executing that here, let me check here, just put, and files are being processed, and I'm just using content-based rules to check my rules and set the file names according to my specification, okay? I have a Sandro, I have a SMIC, and I have a TSMC, okay? So only using, by extending and using these static methods that I create, I now can use it in business rules to help me create my content-based rules processes. A topic that I like is custom functoids. So normally we have a custom functoid created by using the set external function name. Basically, this type of code that you can see in the left, you specify the set external function, and then you create a function, a C# function, to make your operation. In this case, it's a compare operation. This type of function needs to be deployed to your BizTalk mapper in the file system to use in Visual Studio. But you also need to be deployed to the GAC to be executed in your environment. But we have a different type of custom functoids. But basically, instead of using the set external functoid name, we will use a set script buffer. And by doing that, what we are doing is putting all these. You know that if you check, you have this get C# buffer functoid, and if you check this string, it's the same code that you will find in the left. But basically here we are saying that we want to put this code in line in the XSLT file when we compile the map in Visual Studio. So this type of function using the set script buffer, we don't need to deploy to the GAC in our production environment. We only need to have this type of function, the DLL of this type of function, under the BizTalk mapper folder to be used inside of Visual Studio. We don't need to deploy to the GAC this type of functoids because this code is embedded in the XSLT file. I will show that in a moment. But again, another tip, two more tips actually. So debugging orchestration inside Visual Studio, it's possible, okay? It's sometimes useful. The code is a mess, sometimes it's not very readable, but if you get some other project from other teams with a lot of C# code inside of expression shapes, you need to understand that code so you can be able to modify, rebuild in different scenarios, and for example put this code in a helper class without putting this entire C# code inside expression shapes. Because for me, expression shapes should use the less code as possible. The rest is better to have in a support file, for example. It's better for debugging and for reading and maintenance and so on, in my opinion. But sometimes you get this other project from all other teams that arrives to you and you need to make changes or modify, and you need to validate, you need to understand the logic inside. And sometimes be able to debug this orchestration inside Visual Studio to check this code inside the orchestration is is nice, is a good thing to do. And fortunately for us, it's possible. Okay, I don't say that you should do that. You should do that in this type of case scenarios. Okay, so in the BizTalk 2017 R2, you can see that each map or schema has a C# file also, even pipelines. But you don't see orchestrations with a CS file, a class file, in the same directory in your project. However, they are there, but instead they are in the object debug BizTalk xlang folder inside your project. And you will not see the name of the orchestration as a CS file. You only see file 0, file 1, and so on as class files, but these are the match of your file orchestration files. So you can open these files in Visual Studio, attach to process, a BizTalk process, and debug the code inside. I will show you in a moment the code that you look like. But the last tip for developers is database lookup. I'm also intrigued by the string that I need to provide to this database lookup. Or what I mean is the second parameter of this function is the connection string for the database. I never know by default what to put there, and I always need to check what is my connection and so on. I'm not saying that you should put the string there, as you see in the picture, you shouldn't, but just for testing, let's say you need to put this string there, because you should put this type of strings of connections inside SSO or different place that you can reach without changing your code. An easy way to do that is to create a ODL file and just create the configurations there, and you can test also if the connection is good or not, and open in Notepad and see the string and copy this string and put in the in your database lookup. Well, let's see this working. Okay, let me close that, and let me go here, and sorry, my mouse is okay. So, in this case, I'm using a set script functoid, but I could use the set external functoid. If I use a set of external functoid, I need to use this type of code. Otherwise, I have this code here that is the same. Well, when I use that on a map, let me check if I have a map here. Okay, database lookup. No, sorry, it's not that.
Sandro?
Yeah.
I think we are running out of time. It's about hour and a half now. So probably I think some people, they need to go, or it's been getting
okay.
Late. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, so let me just move on. So you can see that, for example, the file, the debugging orchestrations, is similar to that code, but you can use that for debugging. It just let me finish the rest quickly. Backup only happens one a day. Be aware of that. If you want to force a full backup, you need to execute the first full backup sharpshooter and then execute the backup. You can also create a different store job to force and call this automatically for you. I will skip. Validating RosettaNet message is a challenge in BizTalk because you need to extend the schemas with the XML SSD, and this will create a prefix that will give you a problem. You just need to generate the message, go remove that namespace and validate against the schemas. Just be aware of that. And two tips out of topic. Be confident. Your body language also affects the way other people see you. So try to have a confident posture in your life and also have impact in your success. And at the end of the day, just enjoy some time with your family, drink a beer or something like that. The problems will be there tomorrow and we will fix that, okay? So, thank you. And if you ask for something like that, I don't know how this works, Arvana, but you can help me.
Sorry, say again, Sandro.
Arvana?
Yeah.
Questions? If some people want to put, how can I respond?
Yeah, I think there is a Q&A section there.